Tilata, Ejaria, Tamatilata, Ejaria, Jaria, 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 Kupoe. Yeah!
Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me, yeah. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good.
To be part of the rehearsals for this show. I'm representing the banjo faction of the show. My name is Kaia, and I'm gonna play you an original song that I wrote that's called Nine Pin.
I've drowned the leaves of 30 men.
take me home? Oh, Lazarus, won't you take me home? And it poured down from the mouths of babes, locusts and land of grave. Are you wild and gone astray? Oh, brother dear, bear me away. Brother dear, bear me away. This is an old country for lovers.
I know the grandmother one had hands. I know the grandmother one had hands, but they were always in bowls, folding, pinching, rolling the dough, making the bread. I know the grandmother one had hands, but they were always underwater, sifting rice, bluing clothes, starching lives. I know the grandmother one had hands, but they were always in the earth, planting seeds, removing weeds, growing knives, burying sons. I know the grandmother one had hands, but they were always under the cloth, pushing it along, helping it birth into skirt, dress, curtains to lock out night. I know the grandmother one had hands, but they were always inside the hair, parting, plaiting, twisting it into rainbows. I know the grandmother one had hands, but they were always inside pockets, holding the knots, counting the twisted veins, holding on to herself, lest her hands disappear into sky. I know the grandmother one had hands, but they were always inside the clouds, poking holes for the rain to fall.
Thank you. and jacket. Straighten up and fly right. Straighten up and fly right. Straighten up and fly right. Cool down and hop up to go get top. Aim for you, say diving. What's the use of jiving? Straighten up and fly right. Put down the papa, don't you blow your top. The brother told the monkey you were choking me. Release your hold and I will set you free. The monkey looked the brother right dead in the eyes. And the story so touching, it sounds like a lie. Straighten up and fly right. Straighten up and stay right. Straighten up and fly right. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That's not on the program. That is Scott Joplin's masterpiece from 1899, Maple Leaf Rag. Yes. I'm gonna play another piece that's connected to, it's the man who actually, one of the people that followed Joplin, one of the great masters of the piano, early jazz stride, was a man named James Price Johnson, James P. Johnson. He was one of the masters of stride piano. They called him the father of stride. He was Fats Waller's teacher, among other things. He wrote this great piece in 1923, and it became the dance theme of the 1920s. So we're celebrating 100 years of this song, Charleston. I'm just gonna play the chorus for you. I'll be glad to meet and greet with you all after the show in the lobby. And I have a limited amount of merchandise. So if you'd be interested, I'll be interested in signing and purchasing. thank you. I'm going to introduce to the stage now the wonderful and fantastic, I have so many other words to say for him, Jimmy Payne Jr. Thank you.
Thank you. top that, if you're able, I'm gonna catch my breath and have a little sip of water, and we'll set out some chairs, and you're free to ask us questions. Thank you.
The title of the exhibition and this entire menu of programming that started in the spring and runs until October is called Jagged Path. So it only, you know, makes sense that we start with this whole definition of the term. And rather than giving you the definition of the term that started the exhibition, which you can read about in the book, and see in the exhibition as you read the panels, is I'm allowing us, having created this experience for you this afternoon, have each of the participants in their own way define that term, Jagged Path. We're gonna look at it this way. In the spirit of SNCC and the story circle concept, as we pass the mic, I want each person authentically to think about something in your own experience as an artist that was a challenge, that was a jagged portion of your journey. And if you can't think of something that you want to share personally, if you don't want to be that vulnerable, then share the story of someone else who was a Black performer. It could be someone that you know personally. It could be someone that you know historically. And that way, we'll bring those stories into the room as part of our discussion, just to sort of prime the pump. And then we'll go back into talking about this actual experience we had. And you might even talk about the path to getting here. You can talk about the path to creating the piece that you shared with us today. So, I will start. No, I will start with the first person that wants to go. Oh, well, he tied. Oh, no, okay, we're gonna start here.
Okay, cool. Okay, hi, my name is Jimmy Payne Jr. When I think about a jagged path, I think that there's a lot of straight paths in a jagged path. So basically, a jagged path is just about change. So of course we see, you know, we see the big picture, and that's the jagged path, but within that is, you know, there's change. So basically, to me, a jagged path is navigating change. One thing that I'm dealing with right now is rheumatoid arthritis. So that's, I mean, I have to watch what I eat. And I just really have to watch my health if I want to continue dancing. So that's I think of a jagged path.
Well, my jagged path is ragtime. That's jagged in one sense. Another sense, because the music is, you know, very ragged and jagged. I'm self-taught, so it was not easy. And I had no one told me to play this kind of music. I actually took it on because I was very interested in the music, and just teaching myself. Over the summer, I've seen friends and family going out. Everyone was doing what people do in the summertime, going to have fun. And I was at home, mosquitoes and all this stuff bite me, trying to learn how to play Scott Joplin's music by ear. And I eventually taught myself within 3 years, pretty much mastered the music. And you know, so it's, even after winning an award, MacArthur Award, is still jagged now because it's just difficult trying to get people to take the music serious. It's part of African-American music, but it's still difficult trying to get people to respect the music and musicians. So people really don't know. It was like 30 year period of music, 30 or 40 year period of music. So anyway, I just wanted to mention that. So that's my jagged path.
I think I probably would think of Jagged Edge at some point in my life. I didn't know what I wanted to do, whether if I wanted to be a football player or whether if I wanted to be, you know, I wasn't sure. So the arts was presented to me and I took it on, and And when you first started doing, you know, as a dancer myself and a teacher, I just didn't know exactly where my path would actually lead me to. A lot of doors opened, and I tried to just move through those doors as they came available for me. And they've actually, it's done well for me, you know. So I feel that the path, or, you know, it may have been jagged, but it kind of smoothed itself out at the end, because it led me to some places that I never thought I would actually end up at. You know, of course, you know, having some help too, and other people motivating you behind you also is a good way to keep your path open as well too, and keep you on the straight and narrow about what you're trying to do with your life. So that's what I would say. Looking into the issue of African dance and music, I just remember one of the things that my director told me a long time ago. He said, look in the paper, there's so many things happening in the world. You have to go out there and you have to find those things. You have to create art based on those kind of things. And those things are really important to the world and people who are around you, because they themselves are dealing with the same things that you're dealing with in the world. And so if you present that in your art, you will be on the straight and narrow.
Here, Sherone Price. Hi everyone, I am Khalid Saleem, and my jagged path started at a young age. I started drumming at a very young age, like about his age, and my first performance, professional performance, was at 8 years old. And as I was learning, I started learning rhythms from Trinidad, Jamaica, Cuba, in different places, and then different places in Africa. And someone sat me down and said, you're not just playing the drums, you're playing history, you're playing culture, you're playing music that goes back to the 12th century and beyond. And that blew my mind. I was a teenager then, and I was in search for that. So anywhere I heard some music, I was there. Congolese, I was there. Tito Sampa, Elijah Kamala, my djembe teacher, I was there. Different places, I would go find it. They say, I'll put it this way. I went to the mountains to get the information. And then I said, well, I'm gonna pass this music on as well. So that's been my path, and that's what I'm doing now.
I'm going to do something a little different and sort of maybe tie together some of those strands that we've started, because as we talk about these things, you're learning a little bit more about the individuals on stage, but I also want to allow us to be able to talk about the work that we saw on stage and how you might want to use this as an opportunity to expand upon it. So I'm going to take the lead by also having some of our elders who have been involved for a longer amount of time in this process, because their path is longer. And I would be remiss to also acknowledge the reigning poet laureate for the state of North Carolina, Jackie Shelton Green. So, I'm not gonna fall off the stage, so don't worry about me, but I will be jumping around. Jackie, would you like to share at this moment?
So greetings everyone, and thank you for bearing witness to such a powerful afternoon. I'm claiming it was powerful. I don't know about y'all, but it was powerful. I'm always reminded that I'm the elder in the circle now. But I own that, I own that. So when I think about Jagged Edges, I think about growing up as a brown, rural, southern girl who becoming the poet laureate of North Carolina has never been on my bucket list, but things happen. But Jagged Paths for me is the power of witness to say that I witnessed so many men and women wrestle with those jagged edges, pick them up, jagged edges there with glass, sharp, dangerous, unbridled. And to be a Black woman in this time right now, we're still in the middle of a jagged path inside of America. So we live in a culture that is dangerous, that is toxic, that does not love some of us back in the way that we love it. So those jagged paths for me has been thinking about how I've seen grandmothers and great-grandmothers wrestle with some flags, wrestle with forbidden grounds, wrestle with doors that close and never opened on them. So I feel like I am blessed, chosen, favored to have voice, the power of utterance. So that's what I think about when I think about jagged paths, is being blessed to see so many people who walked before me dare to not be erased, dare to not be silenced, dare to not be invisibled. So that's my jagged path, and it remains a jagged path. And I don't think jagged paths are bad things. You know, we learn how to hold them and rename them and resurface them and build containers that are different. Dance, music, poetry, all of these containers for helping those jagged edges have voice.
Unscripted, unbridled. This is where we, after having created this thing, especially the people on the stage, because I was just a witness and participant, because Jackie has just said that there are all these modes of expression that help us along the journey. So, tell us more with your name at the beginning.
Hi, everybody. I'm Teli Shabu, you said it well. When I think of Jagged Path, I think of many of the instruments that we play, and the diaspora that they went through. It wasn't a straight path from Africa to here, you know. They bounced around. And then when they got here, some of them were innovated on by those of us who were on the side already. And those innovations then went back to Africa and informed the way these instruments were created, operated, and then came back. So that's a super jagged path right there to me. And when I think of the show that we just did, I think of all these different elements of the diaspora that have not only had a jagged path to get to where they are today, but they had a jagged path to get to this collaboration today.
And this is where we start dropping pins on the map. So, the show itself is talking about the expanding definition of this region that's called Appalachia. I invoked America, I could have said Americas. Diaspora is everywhere people of African descent have found themselves. And so the real root of what we're trying to accomplish tonight, and various people, is to say that we're everywhere, and how we touch each other, and how, like I said, this circuitous path that we have. So, just to have a little bit of audience participation and have everybody to be able to be involved, we're in Western North Carolina. Where's my West Virginia people? West Virginia people, show yourselves, hold your hands up. All right? All right. Chicago people are in the house. Durham folks are in the house. Did any of y'all raise your hands? So I just wanted to amplify that theme, because we're talking about the places that people find themselves. Somebody might want to share in any number of ways, but I also want to take a little time to talk about Black joy. Jagged path suggests struggle and resilience. But would anybody who hasn't spoken yet, we'll come back to you if you want to add. Talk about Black joy from this event, from this experience, from your performance. Thank you.
Hi, everyone.
I am Ifakunbi Shabu. So, Black joy begins with the reasons that each of our art forms exist. Each of these art forms have a source reason for existing. They are rooted in an event that needs to happen. They are rooted in a healing that needs to happen. They are rooted in not just healing for a person, healing for the community. They are rooted in a rites of passage that needs to happen for youth, rites of passage for adults. In African society, there are different rights as you go along. And each of these has, yes, it has a serious side to it, but then there is also the joy that comes once you have passed that stage of initiation or achieved the healing that needs to happen or built a village. And rhythms are played, drummers are called so that this village can be built, because people need joy. We need upliftment as we are building an entire village or farming. Taylor and I were talking about that on our way up here. Drums and music are played for farming. You will find drummers, a whole crew of drummers will come. And during the middle part of the day, a whole nother crew of drummers will come and replace those first ones on the farming site. The joy that is there because we are farming together as a community. We are growing food together as a community. There is Black joy that is there. Each one of these art forms that we participate in is a source for us to go to when we need joy. It's a source to go to when you are in the darkest place in your life. I had a friend from Senegal tell me, they said that, you know, they went through a really, really dark time in their lives, and they went home. And they said, I put on my Senegalese music and I did this movement. And all they were doing was this. And within about 30 minutes of just moving and just, they were fine. That movement is releasing. You're releasing, you know, the things that you need so the joy can come in. A displacement of energy, if you would. It's like putting a vent in your storage shed that's outside so that cool air can come in and displace the hot air. Joy is something that the art forms can provide us. I think it's extremely, extremely important. And the collaboration that we had today created a new kind of joy. I think it was extremely, extremely powerful. And you are sitting in this wonderful joy today. Absorb it. Cherish it. Remember it. Respect it. Honor it.
Okay, we created an atmosphere. And at this time, I want you to be able to participate in this dialogue. Are there any questions that you might have that might even relate to some of the things that you've already heard or provoke new questions from some of the performances that you just witnessed? I think we have a question here in the front.
Something that you think about a lot and you think it's only you, and then you have to literally travel and get confirmed in what I thought was right. I appreciate every performer from your statement about Joplin. I listen to so many different forms of music. I'm considered different. And I hate to say this, but I return the shade with shade and saying, unbeknownst to you, you have not been informed. My culture created everything that you are. It's not an opinion, it's a fact. And the history of Joplin, the history of you, young lady, with the banjo, it's just a justification where literally my playlist is everything and anything. And I appreciate all of y'all. My question is to you and the young dancer in, I hope that's blue and white, if not black and white. What was the inspiration of your duo performance?
Yeah, sure. Thank you so much for what you said. I completely identify with everything you said. My playlist has everything and anything on it. My name is Kaia, and this is Katharine, and this is Cade. And the piece that we did together is called Rising Down. And I would say we owe a lot of it to our professor and our mentor, Miss Laurie Goux, who's sitting just over here and who put the show together. Katharine and I were going to school at Davis and Elkins College in Elkins, West Virginia, which is a very white school in a very white town. And we decided to do an independent study with Laurie. So every Wednesday night we would go, we'd have dinner and go see Laurie. And the idea was that we would create.
Late and they had to bring me coffee. When they
we were late every time. She's calling us out. And so the idea was that we were gonna create a piece. And I must have been 20 at the time, Katharine was 18. And we were really into like Rihanna and Beyonce, and we would keep bringing these songs to her and being like, why don't we cover a Beyonce song? And Laurie was like, no, we're not doing that. You have to create something original. And that really scared me, because I think at the time I was studying the banjo and it was all about preservation and tradition and hearing something and then repeating it back. And this was, I believe it was in 2014. The winter of 2014, Laurie said, go home. over winter break, write something and come back to me with something. So I had this assignment and I went home to Toronto and I was watching the news and it came on the news that a young boy named Tamir Rice was shot and killed. And he was playing with a toy gun and some police officers ran up on him and killed him. He was 12. And that rattled me the same way that all of the other, you know, black deaths at the hands of the police rattled me. And I had Laurie's voice in my head saying, write something, write something. And so I decided to write this song, but before I did, I went and looked up Ngoni tuning. I went and looked up on the internet. I just felt like the tuning that I had that was like the old time tuning wasn't right for this song. It needed to be deeper. And so I tuned my banjo to like an approximation of an Ngoni. And I started writing this song. And I took it back to school and played it for Laurie and Katherine. I remember that. And Laurie said, that's the one. That's the one that we're gonna, that's the song that you've been needing to write. And I'm gonna pass it off to Katherine.
Yeah. Okay. So I guess I'll start with right before Christmas break when we were bringing Beyonce songs and Rihanna songs and Mama Lori was like, no, you need to be original. Like, don't bring any Beyonce. So I went home on winter break, not really thinking too much, definitely watching the news. And we had a little check-in and Kaia goes, you know, I wrote a song. And I was like, I cleaned my tap shoes. We come back from school and Kaia plays this song and I remember a lot of Wednesdays just sitting, listening to the song and just crying for rehearsals because it was really hard to, you know, how do you create something that speaks to everybody? And that's what I struggled with, like I guess my jagged path. I wanted to create something that was so powerful and spoke to everyone, but I didn't know how to do it. And after I heard, you know, Kaia's song, you know, stuff started coming to me. And I, as a tap dancer, I think my strong suit is improv. So I like to make things up on the fly. Most of what I did today was made up on the spot. And that's where I find like my peace and my calming. That's my strong suit. And things started coming together. Mama Lori, you know, she said some modern on us that we can't do a cartwheel. And it was we needed to do a cartwheel, couldn't do it. And we ended up taking the piece to ACDA in Atlanta, Georgia, which is a dance conference. And we didn't get it adjudicated, but when we did it,